I got Starlink during the public beta a little over a year ago. I set up Dishy on my roof, I set up some advanced monitoring, and tested it as a backup internet connection, but ultimately passed it along to my cousin, who's using it on her farm.
I'm skeptical, very skeptical.
I've burned her like twice on this.
This might just be the next thing that we start our cousin family feud about.
When I first got Starlink, I was getting speeds above 100 megabits down and 15 or so up. It was pretty consistent too. But now my cousin's consistently getting lower speeds, about half what I got last year. It's not bad at all compared to her old DSL. That had upload speeds in the kilobits and cost about the same as Starlink. But it is less, and that seems to be a universal issue for Starlink's early adopters, at least in the US. Pretty much across the board, people have experienced slower speeds as the satellites and ground stations got more saturated. But that's to be expected. I mean, they have 500,000 customers now, and SpaceX is currently making 20,000 new terminals per week. And the day after I posted my last Starlink video, SpaceX announced official roaming support. Users could officially move their Starlink terminals to locations away from their service address. And just this month, the FCC approved Dish's In Motion. This roaming feature comes with a fee, $25 a month, but this created a bit of a loophole for people who live in places where Starlink isn't currently available but has coverage. People are buying Starlink at one address, turning on roaming, then using it at a different address in a cell that's already full. And what problem does that create? Oversubscription. Capacity is SpaceX's number one challenge, and it'll still be a challenge with tens of thousands of satellites up in the air, because despite laser links, more ground stations, and better software, physics just can't be beat, at least not in any short-term timescale. There are tons of reports of Starlink users who aren't roaming, but they're getting lower speeds and higher latency. And sure, SpaceX has some toggles to deprioritize traffic for roaming users, but all networking equipment has capacity limits. Once you reach a certain number of connected devices, performance drops off for everyone. Elon Musk even acknowledged the problem. He said the Bay Area is already saturated with user terminals, and there would be a giant improvement with V2 sats. We'll get to V2 sats later. My best guess is in really popular areas or travel destinations where lots of RV users congregate, Starlink performance might be a lot less than the 100 plus megabits I was originally getting, at least for now. Even with slower speeds, for many customers, it's such an improvement over what they had before, they don't care. Heck, this Reddit user is perfectly happy getting 30 megabits. And for every speed test rant over on Reddit, there are probably a dozen more happy customers like this one from Western Colorado who don't see performance issues at all. Outside speeds, I'm a little disappointed with a couple other things. People who pre-ordered years ago are often still waiting, while people who buy with roaming at a different address can cut in line. Sadly, outside of disabling roaming, there's not a whole lot Starlink can do here. The saying is cheaters never prosper, but in the case of getting Starlink sooner, they do. Also, remember how the new Starlink router doesn't have Ethernet built in, so you have to buy a separate accessory just to get a LAN port? I didn't notice at first, but it's also missing a visible status light. Unless you pick the thing up, the only thing you'll see on it is a picture of the Earth to Mars transfer orbit. To even see if it has power, you have to pick the thing up and look at the status LED on the bottom. Status LEDs are like step one in diagnosing any problem. Heck, those posts on Reddit are proof you shouldn't take away literally the only indication if something is working or not. I mean, at least it's not a blinding blue LED like the one on my network switch, but still, wow. I mean, even though the old router fell over if you looked at it wrong, at least it had a status LED and a network jack. While we're on the topic, some users are building their own PoE boards for the router. Kudos to them, but if Starlink used more standard connections, you wouldn't have to do that at all. Another fun feature I was reading about recently is Starlink's inability to run local firmware updates. So, like, if you stow your dish too long, there's a chance it'll never connect again. And Starlink support will tell you there's nothing you can do about it. Like, there's a wired router. Surely Starlink could build in a local firmware update mechanism, right? Oh wait, they took away the LAN jack, so you'd probably have to buy another dongle just to do that. But seriously, firmware updates are like electronics design 101. It's just ridiculous that the answer to someone storing their dish for too long is throw it away, especially when the hardware costs thousands of bucks to make. But that's all assuming you get a response from Starlink support in the first place. Now, let me be clear. Every support rep I've worked with has been awesome, but there are just not enough of them. Users have reported delays up to a month before they get a response. That's just not acceptable. He'll never see this, but Elon, man, seriously, spend a little less time choreographing dancing robots and focus on your users. They still love Starlink, but it's like you're trying to make them hate it. This next thing, I can't verify 100%, but it looks like some users are getting refurbished or used Starlink terminals. Now, first, let me be frank, it would be good for SpaceX to sell refurbished gear. That's less e-waste, it's good for users since existing gear can be reused, but if you're gonna do it, you have to tell the customer. Heck, a lot of customers would probably be perfectly fine getting a used terminal instead of a brand new one, but if it's refurbished, you just gotta be upfront about it. Starlink also launched Starlink for Business recently. You pay about 5 times as much for a better dish and about double the performance. But I can't really judge the business plan yet. As far as I've seen, this video from TabGeeks is one of the first installs with the actual square dish, and that video didn't really have any performance data, so I'm waiting to see how Starlink Business actually pans out. And how about those fabled Gen 2 satellites that are supposed to solve many of the performance problems with Starlink? Well, they're about 5 times heavier than the original sats. Because of that, they can't be launched on a Falcon 9. SpaceX is betting Starlink's future on a Gen 2 satellite that hasn't been tested in orbit, and it requires a rocket, the Starship, that hasn't even launched yet. I do think Starship will launch, but there are definite concerns over the Gen 2 satellites. Like, SpaceX's original goal was to launch tens of thousands of V1 sats. People rightly worried about short-term effects of a satellite collision, or deorbits. I think some of those concerns were overblown, but that was with a 500-pound satellite. What happens if a few of those 1.2-ton satellites break up? The orbit will decay, but can SpaceX guarantee it'll still burn up before it hits the ground? A lot of Starlink's future rides on the combined success of both Starship and the V2 satellite. A lot has to go right to get both of those in orbit quickly. Otherwise, Starlink's gonna suffer from performance problems all the time, not just during rush hours. Starlink is not in beta anymore, even if it feels like it for many customers. SpaceX doesn't have an excuse. They have to figure out how to provide a decent level of service for existing customers and help the thousands of people still waiting in the pre-order queue. And Musk fans need to realize that just because Starlink is way better than the DSL or dial-up rural customers had before, that doesn't give SpaceX any right to slack off on customer service or provide worse latency and bandwidth than they originally promised. But in the end, like I said before, and I'm sure some people already went down to the comments to lambast me before hearing this, I want Starlink to succeed. If nothing else, I want it to spur competition again so our internet infrastructure can improve in the US and around the world, even for people who are far from cities. After the last 3 Starlink videos I posted, the next day there was some major new announcement from SpaceX, so maybe I'll make it 4 for 4. Hey, it's me in the edit here, and what do you know, Starlink did have a major announcement the day after I recorded that script. They announced Starlink Maritime, a service that costs $10,000 up front and $5,000 a month. They'll send 2 terminals for sea vessels with download speeds around 350 megabits and uploads capped at 40. This isn't for your average houseboat though, it's meant for people who have marine vessels and need high speed on the high seas. The best thing is, if they can figure out laser links so they can get Starlink beyond just the coastlines, landlubbers probably won't affect speeds way out in the ocean, at least as long as you don't get waves crashing over your dish. Until next time, I'm Jeff Geerling.